Okay, yeah, I had it right here.
Oh, you did?
Yep.
Okay.
I do. Okay, I want to welcome everybody to the January 24th PVUSD regular board meeting. I am opening up this meeting at 6:04 p.m. and wanted to see if there are any members of the public that have put speaker cards in for any of the closed session items. No speaker cards? Okay, so seeing none, we'll close the open portion and adjourn to closed, and we'll be back at 7 p.m. Okay. Oh, I am on. Okay. I'm gonna open. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for being here, and Happy New Year. I feel like it's been a long time since New Year's, but we haven't seen each other in a while. So welcome. I'm Leslie DeRose. I'm your board president for this coming year, and Maria Roscoe is our vice president. So we're looking forward to a great semester and rest of the academic year. So I haven't done this in a little while, so give me just a moment to get through to where I need to be on this agenda. Okay. So we're going to go ahead and start with the Pledge of Allegiance, which is item 3.1. And I will ask Trustee DeSerpa to lead us.
Thank you. Flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Thank you, Trustee DeSerpa, and again, want to thank you for your service as president last year.
Thank you.
Item 3.3 is superintendent's comments.
Okay, well, welcome back to our second semester. I hope that everyone had a wonderful time off with their families and friends. For this past year, we've been working with aligning our classroom environments to 21st century learning. So in a minute, I'm going to invite you to enjoy this short video that highlights our 8 new locations. So bienvenidos a nuestro segundo semestre. Espero que hayan tenido un descanso maravilloso con su familia y sus amistades. Este último año hemos estado trabajando en alinear el ambiente de nuestros salones al aprendizaje del siglo XXI. So los invitamos a disfrutar de este breve video que descata los 8 nuevos salones. So aquí estamos.
My favorite method for me personally.
Today you're going to make a demonstration of what you've created.
Pajaro Valley Unified School District, PVUSD, is committed to helping students become college and career ready by creating learning environments that are efficient, adaptable, and collaborative.
One of the things we're creating in these 21st century learning environments is a place for the students to collaborate. We want them to think creatively. We have to get them up and out.
What is this for?
Oh, when someone talk.
My favorite method for me personally.
Today you're going to make a demonstration of what you've created.
Pajaro Valley Unified School District, PVUSD, is committed to helping students become college and career ready by creating learning environments that are efficient, adaptable, and collaborative.
One of the things we're creating in these 21st century learning environments is a place for the students to collaborate. We want them to think creatively. We have to get them up and out.
What is this for?
Oh, when someone talk.
Remember, there's going to be 3 parts to your presentation. Having a 21st century classroom has definitely changed already my approach to teaching.
In what different ways can people be intelligent?
What are some learning strategies that's going to help Adon learn?
Logical mathematical.
What are the best ways for you to learn?
By interacting with people.
What type of intelligence do they have? Are they kinesthetic learners? Are they linguistic learners? They're now taking that information and sharing and creating Google Slides.
And what's the four represent?
All of these combined.
So within this space, I'm able to work with small groups of students. What would the array look like if it was 4x4? Would it be bigger or smaller?
Bigger.
One of the things we do in math is try and explain not just the answer to the problem, but how we solve the problem. They record themselves explaining their thinking, and then we will watch it together as a class. They're reading about engineering and what that's like, and then they're experiencing it through the building of the toys.
These classrooms support students developing academic content knowledge through application with hands-on practice.
This is a 3D pen. It works like a glue gun, only the filament that you use is a harder plastic.
To innovate and be creative, students need flexible learning environments that give them more control over the time, place, and pace of their learning.
The classroom is set up with the front half of the classroom for direct instruction with a variety of seating choices.
I think everybody was really excited when this room was made. There are tables that help with group work and tables that help with independent work.
I like it because we get to interact with different people and actually move around.
You get more work done because you feel more comfortable talking to that person.
Students are currently drawing their interpretation of Maslow's pyramid, Maslow's hierarchy of needs, which is a way to understand how humans are motivated.
The 3D pens can help them visualize how line might become shape and then form.
On the circle, how does it have to flow?
Circular.
That's right, through your body, huh?
Yeah.
And so today's all about closing circuits. They're using alligator clip wires to connect to paper, and then that's gonna go to a computer board, and then that's gonna plug into a computer.
I can't believe the opportunities that our students have today. They're trying things that they couldn't even have imagined existed just a few years ago.
PVUSD has begun this process by designing and creating 8 new 21st century learning environments across the school district.
Have you ever heard the tragedy of Dark Plagueis the Wise?
We're learning about the different jobs that exist within video production.
So I'm going to try and fix the audio because there's a lot of music.
The kids bring over iPads and they learn how to use iMovie. We're using Google Classroom, Google Docs, Google Slides, the whole apps for education.
Whether they are in the form of a makerspace or a fab lab, flexible learning environments will support social engagement and critical thinking.
We need to get students ready for jobs that involve working together, that involve technology. Having a classroom already model that for students is just really imperative to giving them the best education that we can.
There you go. Now you're going.
So anyway, so hopefully you enjoyed seeing a little glimpse of three of our 21st century learning environments. We have 8 currently, and we plan to continue to expand in years to come. And so all of this came about through a proposal process. So what happened is the sites were able to submit proposals, and then we in turn selected the best 8, and so we'll be doing more proposals. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. That was amazing. I couldn't even imagine, you know, when we were in school, that 3D pen was pretty something. So we have moved student recognition up to sooner on the agenda because we understand that students have to go home and do homework, and there's family things that have to be done. So we're going to start with Aptos Junior High's Nicholas Lenner. So family, anybody that's here, come on up.
Let's see if we're on. Good evening. My name is Rich Moran. I'm principal of Aptos Junior High School. So good evening, President DeRose, Dr. Rodriguez, trustees. It's a pleasure to be here. This is always a pleasure to come to this event. And I always feel confident in the students that we're presenting, and I absolutely feel that way again. Historically, I read what I've written because it's a little better, and I put some time into it, and I think this does Nico justice. This first thing you'll notice about Nicholas A. Lerner is his character. And the reason you'll notice it is because the most obvious indication of his character is clearly his smile, which he utilizes often while being kind and polite. The young man is confident, and his sincerity is striking, something that commands attention. However, his most defining character feature is his desire to help others and contribute to his community. During the 2016-17 school year, I first really met Nico because he and his mother had planned and executed a fundraiser to raise some money to support Valencia School. Both volunteered their time and effort to garner resources and to support others. And Nico was pretty diligent in doing that and making sure I knew what was going on and making sure that I had a part to play. And it was nice to engage with him. And again, always polite, always confident, but always clear about what he needed me to be doing. And I really appreciated it. More recently, Nico has spent his time serving as a representative of the Aptos Junior High School leadership class. He's one of three students that have chosen to take this elective for two consecutive quarters. During this time, he's helped and or spearheaded efforts to support the Second Harvest Food Bank food drive, the development of public service announcements, or PSAs, meant to address a positive school climate and culture, and contributed countless to Spirit Days. Again, all of his efforts are geared towards supporting others. But that's not the only aspect that we appreciate about Nico. Additionally, Nico has utilized his creativity to develop the more entrepreneurial side of his character. His interest in bees started as a science project, so it started in school and science, of course. Thank you, Nico. And has evolved into a business, Bee Smart. Nico sells handmade honey and uses the proceeds to add to his savings, of course, or reinvest in the business. In addition to these many contributions, Nico also makes a contribution to our academic culture by maintaining a GPA of 3.4 or higher and participating in our honor roll breakfasts and academic awards. Though his efforts are a function of personal goals and family values, his efforts contribute to something greater, and that's Aptos Junior High School and the community that's Aptos Junior High School. And before I ask Ms. Ulrich to say just a few words about him, when I read through this and I think about Nico, I think honestly about how sincere he is when he engages you and when he talks with you. And it's something that it took me by surprise, and it was striking. It wasn't just a one-time moment. The more you converse and the more that you engage with Nico, his sincerity will stick with you. And if he's not smiling, something's wrong, because he typically is, and he wears that smile, and he uses it to engage others. So it's always a pleasure to be with Nico, and it's my pleasure to present him. But I'd love, Ms. Ulrich spent more time with leadership with Nico, so I'd love for her to have a few words.
Hi, I'm the leadership teacher at Aptos Junior, and thank you for showcasing students and honoring their work that they do in the classroom every day and in our school communities. Nico is one of the best. He represents that responsible, open-minded, wonderful, engaging student that I haven't had in a long time. He's brave, he's persistent, and he's steadfast. And others are always encouraged by Nico and then his willingness to do those big jobs and those little tiny jobs at 7:30 at school when he's working with me all by himself. I want to thank his parents and all of his family for supporting Nico in all of his endeavors. As you see, they're very vast. And I look forward to hearing all about Nico in the future. So thank you.
So hold on, we have more for you.
Hi, Nico. How are you? I'm Kim. I'm one of the board members, and we have a lot in common. I live in Aptos. Where do you live?
In La Selva.
In La Selva, okay. I raised a lot of money for Valencia, and it sounds like you did too, and I love bees. And I love helping other people, and it sounds like you do too. So I want to congratulate you for all your amazing work, and keep it up. You are a shining example of what we would like all of our kids to look like. So congratulations.
Thank you very much.
So if Nico's family is here, anybody that's here to support him, if you'd like to come over for a group photo, we like to do that for our students. Oh, wow, the whole row. Hold on. All right, we can accommodate all of you, don't worry. Congratulations again. Okay, and if anybody has an agenda in front of them, you'll notice that I went out of order. My apologies. Next, we'd like to honor Victoria Munoz from Minty White Elementary.
Dr. DeRosard, I almost started to say dessert because that's the last time I said it, sorry. And Dr. Rodriguez and members of the board. It's my pleasure to honor Victoria tonight and all that she does. I'm going to have her teacher talk to you a little bit more about that. We have her mom and her dad here, and her brothers are here as well. And Andrew Donnelly Crocker, our academic coordinator, is here as well to honor her. So I'm gonna ask Radhika Kirkman, her teacher, to speak on her behalf. But it is also Victoria's birthday this evening.
Birthday. I told her I would not tell you. Good evening. I would like to introduce you to Victoria Munoz, our Student of the Year. Academically, Victoria is both successful and humble. She demonstrates the qualities that we teachers seek in students: the drive to improve and succeed, a hunger for knowledge, and a caring manner. As a student, she is prepared, inquisitive, hardworking, and insightful. She's always willing to work with others and help a friend or a classmate out. And while she has made many achievements in her academics, she's also making great strides as a growing member of our society. As a Minty White Eagle, she exemplifies the three principles of our school: respect, responsibility, and safety. She was elected as our student council representative, and she works every day to provide ideas and solutions for improving our school campus. She is kind, she is thoughtful, she's helpful, and she's very attentive. Each morning when she arrives and each afternoon when she leaves, she has a few kind words to say to you. I know that Victoria is both pushed and supported by her family to reach her highest potential, and that's one of the reasons she is standing here today. Victoria has let it be known that she's interested in becoming a veterinarian in the future, and so I am very excited to see where that takes her and very proud to know that she's going to go far. And now, if you excuse me, I'm going to read it in Spanish for her family, so discúlpame. Me gustaría presentarte a Victoria Munoz, nuestra alumna del año. Académicamente, ella es tanto exitoso como humilde. Ella demuestra las cualidades que los maestros buscan en los estudiantes, el impulso a mejorar y ser exitosa, el deseo de crecer su conocimiento y una actitud afectuosa. Como estudiante, está preparada, es curiosa, trabajadora y perspicaz. Ella siempre está dispuesta a trabajar con otros y ayudar a un amigo o un compañero de clase. Y aunque ha logrado muchos logros académicos, también está logrando grandes avances. Grandes avances como miembro creciente de nuestra sociedad. Como una guía de Minty White, ejemplifica los tres principios de nuestra escuela: respeto, responsabilidad y seguridad. Fue elegida como
representante del Consejo Estudiantil y trabaja para proporcionar ideas y soluciones para mejorar nuestro campus. Ella es amable, consciente, servicial y atenta. Cada mañana cuando llega y cada tarde cuando se va, tiene algunas palabras amables que decir. Sé que Victoria es impulsada y apoyada por su familia para alcanzar su máximo potencial y son una fuerza motriz en sus éxitos. Ella está interesada en ser veterinaria en el futuro y espero ver dónde está ya lleva. Me siento muy orgullosa de poder nominarla como nuestra alumno del año y saber que hay grandes cosas reservadas para ella.
Thank you, President DeRose, the board, and Dr. Rodriguez. I would like to thank Ms. Kirkman and Ms. Hall for kind principal. Also, my mom and dad for always encouraging me when stuff is challenging. My goal is to apply to college and become the vet I want to be, and challenge myself to go further more than from where I am right now. Thank you.
Hold on just 1 second.
A minute, thank you. Victoria, all of us here tonight want to honor you. Thank you for your outstanding work. You guys are going to a great school, and you're a great person for that school. Way to go and keep going. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank
you. Willie, did you want to be in the photo with the group? And anybody else that is here in support, feel free to join the group. Enjoy your birthday. Thank you for spending it with us, too. Oh. Uh-huh. Okay, and now from Lakeview Middle School, Antonia Torres Tinoco. Anyone who's here in support, please feel free to come up.
Good evening, Superintendent Rodriguez, members of the board, and community members. I'm Rosa Hernandez, the principal at Lakeview Middle School, and I'm the super proud principal of this young lady, one of our awesome leaders at Lakeview. We are also very proud of her. Julia Lopez, one of our teachers, will take some time to speak to you about Antonia and all of these awesome characteristics that she has to share with us.
Good evening, I'm Julia Lopez. I'm a science teacher at Lakeview. We're here tonight to recognize Lakeview Student of the Year, Antonia Torres Tinoco. Antonia represents all the characteristics we look for in a Student of the Year. I'm gonna try to keep this short, but she's got an impressive resume at the age of 13 already. Antonia is not only focused on academics, maintaining a 4.0 GPA, she's also a talented athlete and excels at basketball, volleyball, and flag football. Basketball coach called her a beast on the court. And that's a good thing. Because she's not a beast in the classroom. She's awesome. She values community service, and she participates in numerous clubs at Lakeview. She's the president and the co-founder of our ecology club. She's a member of the GSA club, and she's actually, I just realized today, president of Club Live. So she's president of two clubs, of course, because one just wasn't enough. Antonia has represented Lakeview at the Monterey Bay Aquarium's Ocean Plastic Pollution Summit as part of the leadership team for the last 2 years, and we're working on another project this year. In the summer between 6th and 7th grade, she attended the Monterey Bay Aquarium's Young Women in Science Summer Camp. And in fact, she applied for the first year, which is what people do, but her application was so strong that they actually bumped her up to the second level. Let's see. So last summer, Antonia was chosen to attend Algebra Academy. And she also won a very competitive scholarship from the local chapter of the Association of University Women to attend Tech Trek at Stanford. She got to live in the dorms for a week there at Stanford with girls from all over California and work with women scientists to learn about STEM fields. Besides all these accomplishments, Antonia is a really positive force socially at Lakeview. She's a leader on campus. She's respectful and kind to her friends, her classmates, any other students, teachers, and staff. She always has a great attitude. She works hard every day. She always stands up for what's right. She's a positive role model for other students. I've been lucky enough to have her as a student 3 years in a row. And I'm going to miss her terribly when she moves up to high school next year. But I'm confident that she's going to be continuing to grow as a student and as a person. It's my pleasure to congratulate and introduce Antonia Torres Tinoco.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Antonia Torres, and I am the student of the year for Lakeview Middle School. I would first off just like to say thank you to everyone for helping me reach a milestone like this. Thank you so very much. School has always been a very big and important part of my life. I know that if I do well in school, it could be my ticket to attend one of my dream universities. I remember that when I was smaller, I first heard my mom say that school is a privilege. That saying will always stick with me. There are many people who I consider to be my role models, such as my family, my best friends, my amazing teachers, and many others who encourage me to keep doing well. My teachers are the people who teach me that it's okay to be curious and it's okay to ask questions. I appreciate them so much. It is beyond words of how grateful I am for them. Without our beloved teachers, there would be no magnificent lawyers, no life-saving doctors, no curious scientists, and no successful company owners. Teachers deserve the best of the best. I truly believe that. Winning this award has been a very big accomplishment of mine. I can't describe this feeling of being named my school student of the year. It's unbelievable and amazing. I would like to end my speech with a quote from Nelson Mandela. The quote goes, "Education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world." Thank you. All right.
Start bringing risers over there. It's your student board trustee.
Thank you to everyone who came to support our Students of the Year. It's always our favorite part of the agenda. And we look forward to hearing more about what's happening with these students in the future. We have one more? Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry. Rolling Hills Middle School, Stephanie Laura Sotelo. Come here, sweetie. Don't read this. Good evening, President DeRose, Dr. Rodriguez, and board members. My name is Rooney Harper, and I stand in front of you as a representative of the whole staff of Rolling Hills Middle School. We are honored and proud to present to you Stephanie Lara Sotelo as our Student of the Year. Stephanie has attended Rolling Hills since sixth grade and has a cumulative GPA of 3.83. She is enthusiastic. She is motivated, and her enthusiasm and motivation are contagious to everybody in the room. She sits in a quiet corner of the classroom, but there's this electric vibe that comes out of her, not because she's talkative or disruptive, but because she's learning, and she enjoys it. Her leadership qualities shine in the classroom setting and outside. She helps those students around her who need support, and she does it without hesitation and without question, and always with a smile on her face. She's incredibly capable of taking the concepts learned in class and demonstrating mastery with them when working on short and long-term projects. Her intelligence and curiosity are manifested in many ways. Her writing and analytical abilities put her at the top of the class, and yet she's one of the most down-to-earth people you will ever meet. She's shy and unaffected, and that really was what makes her so lovable. She continuously turns in high-quality work with a deep level of understanding. Stephanie also has time for athletics and plays on school's team, and tomorrow she plays in volleyball. So today she's here, and tomorrow she's on the volleyball court. On top of academics, Stephanie is an amazing young woman. Easy to smile and laugh, she's a good friend to many and a happy asset to the class. She's kind and understanding and is willing to help anybody. With Stephanie's many, many amazing characteristics, she will be an incredible asset to PV High School next year. A future immigration attorney, I would like to read to you a part of her third quarter goals. I really don't know what to expect from third quarter, but I know I need to give it my best. The wishes I have for myself are to be able to keep the attitude I have when something changes in my life. I'm always able to maintain a positive attitude, and I really want to keep it that way. That probably is a wish for everybody in this room and everybody in the world. Try your best and be positive. And it is my great honor and pride to present to you Stephanie Lara Sotelo. Stephanie, we have a former trustee that is an immigration attorney, so if you haven't met Doug Keegan, you should go and see him at the Immigration Project. I'm sure he'd love to talk to you. Okay, and again, thank you to everybody honoring our students. So we will go ahead and move on to item 3.5, and that is governing board comments. And I guess we'll just go down the line. Willie, do you have anything?
Just to tell everyone that I've been very ill with the flu and the cold, and I apologize for not being here. I missed a lot of fun, from what I understand, but I would rather be here than have the flu. So thank all of you very much for understanding. Thank you.
So last night I got the opportunity to attend my first DLAC committee meeting. It was great to see how engaged our parents are as part of that committee. Last night they learned about the SMART, School Smarts Academy. They were encouraged to participate as part of that program. But I was also pretty impressed with their election process. So they also hosted their elections last night, and they have a new vice president and president secretary. Thank you.
So these are not totally school things, but they're important. I went to the Martin Luther King March, which was in Seaside. It was incredibly inspiring, not just the march, but the presentations that were at the Oldemeyer Community Center. And I went to a women's rally it wasn't quite a march, but it was a women's rally in Watsonville. We had our own women's, there was women's marches all over the country and all over California, and we had one here in Watsonville, too. It was pretty great. And I screwed up last night. I don't know what was happening to me. I screwed up and didn't go to the DLAC meeting. I completely forgot. I was very bad of me. So, but I'm usually always there. Thanks.
Thank you. So I just have a quick update. A couple of months ago, the board voted to start a new nonprofit foundation, the Pajaro Valley Education Foundation. And over the break, we did move forward on submitting our articles of incorporation, getting our EIN number, and we're in the process of setting up a bank account number and filling out the board seats. So we're going to be wanting to raise money soon. So we are hoping to meet soon and start developing a marketing plan and some goals for our first year fundraising. So as those processes move through, I will be reporting back on that. I'm the president of the foundation. Jeff is clerk, and then Kevin Jeffries from Granite Construction, who is an appointee of Trustee DeSerpa's, is the vice president. And as I said, we do have some other seats to fill as well, and we're exploring opportunities. So we'll keep you posted on that. Okay. Item 4.1 is approval of the agenda, and I do have a correction to, this was there, I hadn't spoken to anybody about it. Is this mine? Okay. On item 11.1, Rio Del Mar Elementary School Campus Modernization Project, on the agenda, funding was noted only as Measure L bond funds, but funding is actually going to be split between Measure L as well as developer fees. Redevelopment. So I just wanted to make that clarification. If we can note that in the minutes, that would be great. With that, I will ask for a motion to approve the agenda with that noted change.
You have a motion to approve the agenda?
And a second, okay. And all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay. None opposed. Motion passes 601. Thank you. Keep looking for a mouse. Sorry. And item 5.1 is approval of the minutes from our December 6th board meeting.
I'll make a motion to approve the December 6th, 2017 minutes.
Second the motion.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Right. I'm asking for abstentions next. So no opposed? And abstentions. Okay. 6-0-1-2, or 4, I'm sorry. 1-2. Thank you. And next is minutes for our financial corporation meeting on December 6th. Looking for a motion.
I make a motion to approve the financial corporation minutes from December 6th, 2017.
Second that motion.
Any opposed? Abstentions? Two? Okay. Motion passes 4-0-1-2 as well. And now meetings for our special board meeting held last week on January 17th. Looking for a motion?
Making a motion to approve the minutes from January 17th, 2017, our special board meeting.
I'll
second. Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, again, 4-0. Oh, wait.
No.
Oh, okay. You wouldn't like this one, ask for abstentions. Okay. 5-0-1-1. Okay. Thank you. And okay, item 6. We always like to hear from our high school representatives, and I see a big smile there. Is this Watsonville High that we have? Okay, great. Come on up and please state your name before you give your presentation. I believe there's a PowerPoint. Okay. Hold on just one sec. Okay, go ahead.
Oh, my name's Karina Navarro. Hello. And I'm from Watsonville High.
Okay, welcome.
Okay, so before I like to talk about what's going on, we just want to say thank you for having the maintenance department come and fix the windows from our south and east face that are facing the windows. And we're really grateful because we hope they're going to be keeping our classes and insulated. And something we would like to tell you guys is our open house is February 1st is at 6 p.m. And you guys are all welcome to join and see what's going to be going on. And then winter sports are coming to an end. And before that ends, we're going to have a winter sport carnival, which is basically just going to help out for students to come and be more engaged to come out and watch the sports, most specifically the basketball games. And then we're getting ready for our track and field and swimming and baseball and softballs. And then something that's coming up that's really important is during February 1st and 2nd, which is SLC recruitment, which is where freshmen go to all the 7 academies that Watsonville High offers, and they learn what happens through those academies, and they get to choose which academy they're going to be in that for the next 3 years. And while SLC recruitment is going to be happening, half of the freshmen are going to go to Civics Day, which is where the freshmen go to town to learn about how our city's government works and the history of our town. And while the freshmen are in SLC recruitment and Civics Day, our 10th to 12th grade students are going to have a career day, which will involve around 60 presenters coming to talk about their careers. And students are going to be able to choose the sessions that they are interested in to learn more about the different careers. And all of that is going to be happening from 8:30 a.m. to 12 p.m., which you guys are all welcome to come and see. And then our Royal Hearts Dance will be the 9th of February. And we have decided to do something where it will help the students to get a discount to the dance and will help them be more active around the school and community, which is called the Passport to Love. And basically what they do is they have to do something, one of the examples would be take a friend to lunch or a new person, and they have to take them out, and then when they come back they have to show the proof. And then they could either go to certain people and they'll have it signed. And each time they have it signed, they get a dollar off the dance, and they will be able to receive up to $5 off, which will help them out by a lot. And then that's pretty much it.
Right. That's very creative. Thank you so much. And do we have any other high schools? I don't think I see anybody else in the audience. Okay. Well, thank you so much for being here. Feel free to stay if you'd like, but we know there's important things to do at home too. So, okay. Do we have any speakers to item 7, 7.1 public comment?
We do. Bill Beecher.
Yeah, we need to. Well, this is what I looked like when I took a look at the SARC and CASP results. And I wanted to represent what Susan had done at a previous time. So as a way of looking at this, this is Aptos PV and Watsonville High School. And if you focus on the level one and level two and where they're at, you see where Aptos actually has gotten worse over the 3 years. And if I look at PVE or Watsonville High, over 80% of the students are below the state average. Over 80% of them are below the state average in math. But I found nearby there are three schools that actually have shown improvement: North Monterey, Gilroy, and San Benito. And you go, well, if they're able to improve, why the heck can't we? Our students are not college ready. I love the presentation early, but the fact is, they aren't college ready. We are failing our students. So, the school board is not doing a thorough review of the academic performance. You see a few slides. There's no reviews that I've seen in the last 4 or 5 years. There's a little bit of data. People feel good about it, but we haven't dug in and looked at what schools are doing well, what aren't. And part of the board's responsibility is actually to hold the administration to these academic measures and take steps if we're not meeting them. Well, I've been coming for 10 years, and I've seen very little improvement. So where's the board? Why aren't you complaining about why we aren't doing better? So actions that should be taken is have a study session. I've recommended this in the past. Talk about what's working, what's not working. What do you learn from all of this? What should we do different? And what districts are improving and why? And I showed you three, and there's a lot more that are doing a good job. So actions that also should be taken is have open meetings with the math and English departments because of their lack of progress. Ask them if they know what the students are missing on the state testing. That's a standard thing to do. What's missing in the lesson plan? Oh, well, they're missing this on the state test. So why aren't they fixing their lesson plans? I don't think they're doing that. Ask them why they would, what they would recommend to improve our performance. They may have some answers and shock everybody. They may not like what they're told to do. And stress that their performance is not acceptable. You can't get results like that and say they're doing a great job. So, without Aptos, PVUSD would be in the bottom 10 percentile in the state. The bottom 10 percentile. There'd be over 900 school districts doing better than we are. So, our students are not college ready. Sorry, Mark. But what are you as a board going to do about it? So thank you for your time. I'd ask you for questions, but.
Thank you, Bill. Do we have any others? No.
8.1.
Okay, so we're moving on to item 8.1. And this is under 8, employee organization comments. We do have a speaker to 8.1, and then we'll hear from PVFT. Who
Bill also?
Yes. Bill Beecher?
Bill Beecher.
It was pointed out to me that at a previous meeting I misspoke. And I'm here to say I misspoke. And it had to do with bilingual teachers getting a stipend. Presently, they don't get a stipend. But I think somewhere in my dreams I was thinking, oh, they must be negotiating to have a stipend for our bilingual teachers. And I don't know that because I'm not privy to what goes on in negotiations. But if that was part of their plank, based on some of the data I just showed you, why would you ever give a stipend to teachers who aren't performing? If they're doing a heck of a job, I'd be the first one up here to say, give them a stipend, but not now.
Thank you. And do we have someone from PVFT? No. CSEA? PVAM? CWA? Okay. No employee organization comments. So we will go ahead and move to action items. And we begin with item 9.1, which is the 16-17 audit report. And this is a report by Ron Forsten, our interim CBO, and Helen Belanzi, our finance director.
And I will ask Helen to introduce the auditor.
Oh, okay, great. Welcome.
President DeRose, Superintendent Rodriguez, Board of Trustees, Cabinet members, I'd like to introduce Joyce Peters from VTD, our independent audit firm, and she is going to give you an overview of our audit report for 16-17.
Thank you. Good evening, trustees. This report is very big. It's 100 pages. So if I'll just give you a really brief view, and then if you're reading it, I think the really place to start is the management discussion and analysis. It gives you a comparison of this year's and past year's financials, and it's a place to start. Also, I would like to let you know the financial statement, it's district's responsibilities. Our responsibility is to express opinions on these financial statements. So the if you want to take a brief look on this financial statements, there's also another page on page like 87. They also give you a very quick glance of past 3 years' operations. That is a good place. And on page 106, that's actually a summary of our opinion and which is our result. And so I would just like to tell you that during our audit, we express three opinions on your financial statements, on your state compliance and federal compliance. On page 106, the financial statements, when we audited it, we actually go through the internal control, walk through it. The purpose of internal control is not to express an opinion on your internal control. The purpose of internal control walkthrough is to plan our audit in according to your internal control. The result of our audit, we didn't propose any audit adjustments, and there's no financial statement findings. So as a result, it's a modified opinion, which in other words, is a clean audit. For the federal awards, any federal program award you receive over $1.1 million is considered a major program. We don't audit all your major program every year. However, we rotate it every year. In current year, we audit your special education and 21st Century Community Center Learning Program. Of these two programs, we did not have any exceptions as well. So it's a unmodified opinion. For the state awards, there's a lot of state compliance the district has to comply with. However, we only audit the one the state asks us to do, which is the program is listed on page 103. And of all those state compliance we audited, we didn't find any exception as well, except one. which is stated on the page 109. That's the only finding you have for the state compliance. However, this compliance is not we are discovering it. Actually, it's discovered by district before we even coming in. And we are just putting it in there because it's for the benefit of the district. So I have Helen here. If you have any additional question, she can give you a more detail. And other than that, the district's audit reports is a very clean audit. Any questions?
Any questions? Ed Willie.
Thank you. On the findings about the free lunch program, and I don't have the page in front of me, but
that's a duplicate student count.
Pardon me?
109. And duplicated student count.
Yeah, there's years ago, because the account was not accurate, we ended up owing the federal government lots of money. Is this going to happen again?
This is a little different. Do you want to elaborate that?
Okay. So our schools, we have, excuse me, I don't remember how many schools we have that are community eligible program for free and reduced, well, for free meals for the students, for all the students in those schools. And what happened is that the students that qualified from the prior year didn't get rolled into the CalPADS data. And by them putting this audit finding in, we are able to count those towards our unduplicated count for 16-17. And there are federal funds that it won't be that we have to pay funds back. What we need to do is we go to the different federal programs and make sure they have the accurate numbers so we get additional funding for these students.
So the answer would be that we don't have to be concerned about the overcounted or undercounted people at the end of the year?
No. What it is we will have this year in 17-18, we will be working with the state to make sure that all the different programs that we get funded on free and reduced have these students included in that. And so we won't be losing funds. We should be getting more funds for them.
There are other programs that use the free lunch program as the basis for their programs, like healthcare through Salute and others. Does this vary and impact all of the other programs that use our numbers?
Yes, and that's why we will work with the different organizations and make sure that our programs are getting the correct numbers counted.
Okay.
So it's not that we're going to lose money. We will get more money, but similar to what we've been getting in the past several years.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Well,
I would like to thank all the business departments' cooperations while we are there. They are actually is very efficient to help us to getting the information's ready and whatever the schedules we requested and all the invoices bought. Thank you.
Kim?
Sorry, I have another question. So this is a positive finding that we found 872 in duplicated kids will be getting more money as a result. So that's really exciting. Do we know about how much money that potentially is?
So we knew about this when we did our unaudited actuals. So these students were included in our calculations for our revenue. So we won't be getting any more money. It will be what we had reported at unaudited.
Oh, okay, that's great.
Yeah.
And so I know that this whole, and you just said this, but I'm gonna break it down further. That it used to be that we had to sort of count per child or look at Medi-Cal eligibility to determine what, you know, our formula for the LCAP so that we could get the most money possible, right? But now we've got entire school settings that we don't have to count per child anymore because the whole school is now included in?
Yes and no.
Okay.
So there's a four-year eligibility. So when we went to it, we rolled the students that qualified for our first year.
Any new students that we get in each year have to fill out an alternative income form. We're no longer able to ask for the free and reduced forms. We have to have an alternative income form, which we have. And then every 4 years, all those schools, all the students' families have to fill out a new alternative income form. So in, I believe, 2021, all those schools will, families will get this form to fill out, and it will start the 4 year. So any new students each year, we need to get the forms from, and then every 4 years, we'll do all the schools. Every 4 years, yes. Yeah.
Okay, and so unmodified means there's really no findings, is that right?
Yes,
yeah. Correct. Okay, great, thank you.
Anybody else?
Leslie, can I ask another question? Thank you. Did you find any findings this year that were findings last year and we did not correct?
No, actually, there's no prior year findings.
There weren't any?
Yeah,
there were no. We always had questions about ASB funds.
Oh, that's okay. Yeah, it's been a few years now. And then usually the ASB findings, unless it's really serious, we usually don't put it in the audit report due to sometimes because it's not material to the financial statement. It's sometimes a messy one. Usually is you can tell in the elementary, and they are unorganized one, and then sometimes they don't have a lot of activities, so you'll see like okay, they didn't deposit timely and all those. But then if you counted the amount, maybe some discrepancies, it's only like 100, 200 compared with you have such a big budget. It's not really financial to it's not really material to your financial statement. So in this situation, usually we work with the school district, have them resolved, and give them some industry trainings and those things to try to improve their accountabilities.
Okay, so your audit report this year does not have any findings at all. Is that right?
Yes, no financial statement findings.
And,
correct.
And the structure of the business department, so forth, well, all of the various offices, and you didn't find any structural problems within the business office itself?
Well, the internal control, we didn't actually express opinions on the effectiveness of internal control. What we did for the internal control audit basically is just obtain an understanding and walk through the whole process, see if it is according to our understandings, and if there's a key control is in place, the design is designed properly. And then we usually look at how tightly the control operate, and then decide how much sample we are going to select it during our audit. So if we think it's really good, and then we select less sample. And then, so that's basic, it's just for our planning purpose. It's not for the express opinions purpose.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I just had, I wanted some further clarification on the 872 students. The report actually says that we omitted those students. So were these students that should have been identified but weren't?
Well, actually, usually when the state, you have to submit those numbers to the state as there's a consensus days, usually in October. And I think the district find out they didn't submit it after October. And then that's why we decide to put it in the findings so the state would pay attention and then tell them that additional omitted students, we actually went in and audited, and it's properly stated, and it should be included, and that's why we put it there. And then the purpose of this finding is tell state that we actually audited those additional ones.
Okay.
So I'll add one more thing. What happened was those CEP schools, the students didn't get rolled into the free and reduced that qualified from the prior year. And we didn't realize that until February, March, which was too late to get it in the CalPADS for the October date. That's why when we contacted the state, mm-hmm. and they said we could, if the auditors put it in as a finding, that we could count those students.
Okay. Thank you. And I think if that's it, right? Okay, and this is an action item. So I'll be looking for a motion to approve the audit report for this 16-17 school year.
I'll move approval.
I'll second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? None. So we've got 503.
Trustee DeSerpa. That's eight people.
But 403. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No, but because Jeff is gone. 502. This is something I'll never get. Thank you for your patience with the math. Okay. All righty. So we are on our next agenda item is the high school on the high school ethnic studies course, item 9.2. And this is a report by our assistant superintendent Lisa Aguirre.
Good evening, President DeRose, Superintendent Rodriguez, and Board of Trustees. In September 2016, Assembly Bill 2016 was passed to encourage any school district with students in grades 9 through 12 to offer a standards-based ethnic studies curriculum. Last week, EdTrust West put out their latest publication called The Majority Report. The report is a rallying cry for student leaders, parents, policymakers, educators, to make changes in our schools for the benefit of students. In the report, it states that research and experience tells us that culturally inclusive curriculum honors the experience of people of color and marginalized populations and turns the curve to engage students and families. And tonight, the Ethnic Studies Committee presents to you the very first PVUSD Ethnic Studies course that, upon your approval, will be offered in the fall of 2018 at our high schools. On behalf of the Ethnic Studies Committee, I would like to introduce Veronica Aguilar, who will present more information about the course.
Good evening. My name is Veronica Aguilar, and I'm the assistant principal of Alianza, but I'm here representing a magnificent group that got together and worked many hours to create a wonderful experience for our students. So I'm going to describe a little bit about So this is for our students and our community. Our purpose is to develop self-awareness of their place in the world. We want our students to know where are they, how they affect, where they live, and the world in general. Create a respect and appreciation of other people. This is a 21st century skill that we need to build for among our students, inside of our students. Consider concepts in relation to their own personal, group, or national identity. This is a really powerful thing for our Latino community. We have a large number of Latinos that need to find a connection in their education. Foster active academic and social engagement in school and encourage students to give back to their community. Once again, reconnect with their community, their ethnicity, their race, their community, and the world that they live in. But aside from that, we also want to focus academically and make it academically rigorous. So we want students to learn how to read well, carefully analyze a broad range of nonfiction and fiction prose selections that we've already, we have a course description where we've made careful selections of what they would be reading. Deepen awareness of how language works effectively, communicating ideas. Educate students to be politically and socially conscious of their personal connection to local and global issues. So we really absolutely need our students, once again, I keep saying, re-engage with their education, their community, and this world. We worked long hours specifically on what would be covered in this course. How can we re-engage our community or students in their education? We would begin with units that would cover their identity, race and ethnicity, prejudice and discrimination, immigration, gender, African American, Asian Americans, First Nations, Arab and Muslim Americans, and absolutely the Latino Americans. This is also in response to the new history and social science framework from the state of California that also has made some changes that includes bringing these communities to the forefront of history and social science curriculum. And I'm going to leave you with one of our inspiration, which is a book by Ronald Takagi, A Different Mirror, that says, what happens, to borrow the words of Adrienne Rich, when someone with the authority of a teacher describes our society and you are not in it? It happens to our students every day. Such an experience can be disorienting, a moment of psychic disequilibrium, as if you looked into a mirror and saw nothing. We want to bring this course to our community to see our students reflected in the curriculum. Our students need to re-engage. We need a rigorous course. We're looking for an English course that sort of brings together also their history, their identity, their race. So that's why we're here. Thank you.
Questions?
No speakers? Willie, I'll start with you again.
Thank you. My concern, I'm all for this course, but I am concerned about not being inclusive with other nationalities that have really made this valley so rich. And I want to make sure that the Slavonian heritage is part of this program. They were one of the first immigrant groups here. The Portuguese, I'm not sure if they're part of this whole program. The Asian community, I just want to be more inclusive. Just to make sure that we have everybody represented, and all views get represented here. Can you answer that question?
Within a short period of time, we can't put everyone, but absolutely we'll go to the historical society that Mr. Beecher referred us to and look at the Slavonians and the Portuguese who are from our actual valley, and we can look at possibly adding them in where it would fit.
Pardon me. I don't think that it's possibly to be added.
We would add them in because they're part they're part of our community.
Correct. Okay. That's my major concern. I want to be inclusive because there's a lot of great nationalities that have been here that worked hard, struggled, and built this valley up. Okay.
So I'll get to you. Just to piggyback on that, when you're doing that, look for all nationalities that may have been missed, because I know the Italian Americans had a huge impact and still do on this area, too. So just.
And one thing I want to mention, that this course is the first course. There's going to be a second course built for juniors that's going to fit under the history and social science. So this is just one of two courses that are being built for the high school.
Okay, thank you. Kim?
So this is, I'm very so excited about this. I think this will be very helpful for kids of color in particular. But what I don't see as a major unit is anything on the Holocaust or Judaism and the ethnic cleansing that happened to those people. I happen to be one of them. So we talked about that the last time you brought it forward, and I still don't see it on here as a major unit, and it just seems like an omission. So does that not get included in the ethnic studies course?
It's not that it won't get included in the ethnic studies course. We can go back and we can put it in.
Okay.
So the thing is, though, we want to make sure, like, this is the beginning of the course where, and the one of the purpose is that the students coming in from eighth grade to ninth grade is where we lose a lot of our students. So one of the big focus is to re-engage them in high school, right, and not make it a course where, so it's more about, it's a lot about re-engagement in a rigorous academic setting. The next course that we're building in the 11th grade, which is more focused on the histories of the world, will have a lot more in it. Does that make sense?
Sure, but when you're talking about oppression, because I'm guessing that's going to be a big feature of
the oppression
teaching
is gonna
kids.
Be, it is going to be a, right. a big feature. And so we'll take it back to the ethnic studies and add it back in. Add it in.
Okay. And then is this an elective? I'm sorry, I missed that. So this is a required course.
It is not required for graduation, but students will receive English credit through the our next steps is that we're going to put it through where they'll receive A through G credit as an English credit.
So they can take this in lieu of a regular literature course?
Yes.
Or okay, great. Thank you.
Really quick question.
My only comment was just that I was just going to chime in, coin what Willie said, in absolute agreement with that, you know, that the design, I believe, of this was that it's about the ethnic groups within the communities and the history of that, too. So as long as that is inclusive of all of that, you know, dating back to the foundation of the history of this valley, then I'm good with it. Thank
so
you.
The history of this valley would go into the immigration, and then the with the Holocaust could go in the prejudice and discrimination, and that's where we'll put the two units.
Right, and I think the big thing that what I'm coining with Willie is the inclusiveness of all nationalities that contributed to this valley.
Yeah, and that's what when we're talking about the all of the nationalities within this valley is where it goes with the immigration.
Thank you for doing this. I know for me it was really important that we would incorporate something like this within our curriculum. So thank you to Michelle for putting the committee together and for the work that the group has done to bring this forward. Is there an associated cost that goes along with this?
For the materials, there is a cost, and it's in the $42,000. And what it's going to come out of is the lottery funds.
Okay.
It's already been identified of which funds it could come out of.
Great. Thank you. I do look forward to maybe seeing a report once this is, you know, after the first year that is given. I think I would want to hear from students and their overall experience.
Rumor has it that PV High has slotted 5 sections.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think it's good to be inclusive, but I also think it's really important for students to learn about cultures that they don't run into as often. For example, African Americans, that's really incredibly important, and their history, and of course the history of this country, the history of slavery in this country, pretty incredibly important for them to understand, and racism and how it's, you know, impacted all cultures, but very, very specifically them as well. and you didn't mention the LGBTQ, that's important to add into it as well, because you said gender, but not the LGBTQ. That's important.
That's up there.
No, I know it's there, but I'm just saying when she was mentioning them, she mentioned gender, but not she didn't add in that one. So that's a very important one to add for students as well. I mean, because, you know, there's different viewpoints, and it's important for them to learn about all of them. That's very important. Thank you.
Is that anything you would like to add, Perla?
I wish I could have taken this in high school, but exactly. It's really exciting that it's going to happen, or hopefully, because especially with, like, in our school, like, I know Watsonville High is, like, 97% Latino, so I think it's really important that students learn about other cultures as well and learn to embrace diversity so they could be more ready for college and be more educated about what's going on. Yeah.
Any other comments from the board?
Oh.
Mm-hmm. If we ever need a student's opinion, right? If we ever need a student's opinion, it's definitely curriculum.
Want to ask, and the Muslim, obviously, culture is really important since there's been history of lately in more discrimination against that culture. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And again, this is an action item. So I'm looking for a motion.
I would like to move.
Okay. And second.
I'll second.
Okay. All those in favor? Aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion passes 6-0-1.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, really quick. When will this be implemented?
This coming fall.
Fall. Okay, great. Thank you. Good
job. Next fall.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All righty, now we're on 9.3, and this is the first reading of the instructional calendars for, time flies, 18, 19, 19, 20, and the 2021 school years. And this is a report by, my screen keeps moving on me. And Dr. Colleen will give us our report.
Adjust the microphone for the vertically challenged. President DeRose, Board Trustee Dr. Rodriguez, before you were presenting the District Calendar Committee update. And the task for the District Calendar Committee, as you can see, is to develop the student calendar proposals for the upcoming three-year cycle, 2018-19, 2019-20, and 2020-21. And it is important that our proposals are in legal compliance, which we need to make sure we have enough instructional minutes and days, as well as service credit days for retirement calculations for our employees. Critical that we maximize opportunities for student academic achievement, such as accommodating the high school final schedule and a longer second semester schedule for the CASP testing. And there was preference expressed by parents, staff, and the community to work on a calendar so that the holiday arrangements would align with neighboring schools as well as city activities. And as you can see from the very large size of this group, it was a pretty collaborative committee despite the size. And we had a lot of help in developing the different proposals from site and district staff, our unions, as well as parents. We had three full committee meeting dates, and we also had a subcommittee that our three assistant superintendents would add services, as well as elementary and secondary education, were critical. And also, if Carol Ortiz is here, give her a heads up as well. And those conversations involve professional development, trimester and quarter, parent conferences, and early release Wednesdays for training. And the committee conducted a needs assessment. I've discussed some of the legal needs, legal requirements, which were the instructional days and minutes, the retirement calculations. And for academic needs, we wanted to make sure that we had a full week for the last week of school to accommodate graduation. And we wanted to coordinate the parent conferences with progress reports and report cards, and more days for second semester versus first semester to accommodate the testing window, and in a mid-August start so high school finals can conclude before winter break. And some of the preferences that were expressed, particularly from some of our parents, they wanted a longer winter break so that there's time for families to engage in a long distance travel and try to match the holiday arrangements with other schools and some city activities.
Next is the current calendar that we have, and it's the first semester is 87 student days, second semester is 93 student days, and then the start days for first semester is 8/16 to 12/22, and then second semester is 1/17 to 6/18. And the next three calendars that you will see align pretty much with what we have with the current calendar. The one thing that we did incorporate is we wanted to include the parent conference week within the calendar, as the teachers wanted to, as the teachers had requested that they wanted to get these more closely aligned with the report card distribution and be able to provide the parents a more comprehensive view of student progress.
I just wanted to take note for the board, if you're having a hard time seeing the visual imprint on the presentation, you can go to board docs and it is the first attachment for you so that you could see it in larger form. I just wanted to make sure that everyone was aware of that in case they couldn't see the presentation. Sorry, go ahead, Dr.
So Cole. That was the next year is 2019-2020. And first semester is 87 days, second semester is 93 student days. Start date for first semester is from 8/14/19 to 12/19/19. And second semester would be 1/14/20 and 6/5/20. And then the last of the calendars would be first semester 87 days, second semester 93 days. First semester starting August 12th, 2020, ending December 18th, 2020, and second semester would be January 13th, 2021, and ending June 4th, 2021. So the next steps, and we are going to continue to make sure that we're giving our staff and our parents and our community a voice in the process by obtaining feedback. So our principals are going to continue to share the proposals with their school site councils, the English Learner Advisory Committees, as well as our special education committees. And our unions will present it to their membership. And PVFT will need to ratify the calendar, and we will bring this back to the board for final approval along with additional feedback. Some of our principals have already started talking with their parents and sharing this with our parents, and our illustrious superintendent has already shared it with our DLAC parents, and they were, and they, she had indicated that they were very receptive, but our superintendent, again, is very persuasive. So I let her share what some of the parents, some of the feedback that they gave us.
Yeah, so at every DLAC, I am there at the beginning of the presentation, and I'm supposed to be held to a 10-minute, and Dr. Gottlieb will let you know I never quite can get myself at that limit. They try to take a cane and take me out. But anyways, so I was able to present this, and I gave them the process. They were very supportive of three key areas. One, that they did have 3.5 weeks to travel because they talked about the necessity to have a longer window so that they could get there and back. Also, the fact that we took in the recognition that they didn't want to have school go to so close to Christmas or a winter break. So this past year, we had school up until the 22nd. So getting somewhere starting the 23rd was very challenging. So you'll see that indicated in this. And then also they did express that it was a positive that it was aligned with the city. And with other and with the county, because a lot of the employers were the three largest employers of the people around, and so they were glad that we were going to be taking it back to the school site councils, and they'll make sure that other parents, as they're the representatives, are informed of that feedback time.
At this end this time. Are there any board comments and any from our student board trustee? Nope. Oh.
calling someone else. It seemed like we had such a long winter break this last winter, and I'm just wondering, do we really need that? And couldn't we have a ski week, like, sometime in February, you know, corresponding to President's Day or something? Because it's just such a long, cold winter. It's nice to, for families to be able to go on ski trips instead of taking their kid, pulling them out of school, potentially. Or it doesn't have to be a ski trip, but, I mean, a lot of families can't afford that. But other ideas about breaking up that very long winter holiday?
What we wanted to do with the winter break is, particularly for the high schools, we wanted to make sure that we got their finals done before they go into winter break, so they don't have that 2 or 3 weeks then, you know, in the winter, forgetting everything that occurred first semester and then coming in to do the final exams. And so when we count back from the winter break. And because of the STRS and PERS retirement calculation for service credit, second semester needed to start in June, so we count backwards from that 1 week in June into January. So that, hence, that leaves us that 3 week winter break. And spring break is a little bit longer than, spring semester, or second semester, is a little bit longer than first semester, because we do have CAS testing taking place during second semester. So we want to make sure that we give time for that testing window. And there needs to be some, you know, a little bit more instructional time built in.
I did really appreciate that our district takes into account concluding finals before the break. A lot of other districts did not do that, and I felt so badly for all these kids that were going back into their first week of school, back from their breaks, having to do their finals. It's just nice to wrap that up. So as a parent of a teenager, I really thank the district for moving in that direction, because when I first started here on the board, we weren't doing that, and kids were coming back. They're just super stressed out over their whole break studying, So I like that. I noticed that when is Easter this year? When is Easter?
March 3rd.
It's on
here. April. It's like the first Sunday in April, I think.
Oh, when Easter is? I don't know. I'm sorry, I was referring to the break.
I didn't asking about Easter.
I'm sorry, I don't know.
Well, Semana Santa is such a, Easter week is such a holy week for our Latino community, and we used to have the break aligned with that week so that families could travel if they wanted to, but then that changed. So is Easter on, when is it?
April 1st.
It is April 1st. Oh, so it's aligned. Okay, thank you. That was my question.
Maria?
Yeah, just to piggyback on what Kim said regarding the December, the winter break, mm-hmm. At least from the feedback that I've received for parents, that's what they prefer. For the same reason that they often run into the issue that wherever they decide to travel, they never make it back on time, so their kids end up missing a week and a half of school. So I think in the interest of at least the parent feedback that I've received for South County schools, they really did like that change for that reason.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Did we look at the attendance of teachers and students? And as an example, I think 1 year we looked at Good Friday during that week, and everybody was gone on Friday, so we just made it a day off or whatever.
That isn't incorporated in here. We did have Penny Colburn. She's a student attendance specialist. We wanted her on the committee to speak to attendance, and that was one of the points that we discussed in the committee. So if you wouldn't notice that... the Good Friday, because of, you know, our population, that's part of when we start. So if so that Good Friday is part of our spring break, as mm-hmm. we on all three of the proposals.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Okay, if there's no more discussion, this is an action item to approve the first reading of the instructional calendars.
I so move.
Second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? None opposed? Motion passes 6-0-1. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. Item 9.4, this is a report by our superintendent on an agreement for a summer program with Digital Nest.
So we have a really great collaborative relationship with Jacob Martinez, who is in who is a founder of Digital Nest. And so we have been looking at different ways in which we can really build the interest and motivations of our students. And so for that reason, we were talking about what would be additional ways in which to support students that need that push and that motivation to really look at different careers, but are currently still underperforming at school. So last year, what had happened is we tried to get students in Digital Nest, but what we found out was that many of those students that were wanting to engage with Digital Nest had to take credit recovery classes. So what we have come to an agreement on, and I think it's going to be fantastic, is that we will work with Digital Nest to have a subset of our students who need credit recovery that are going to be doing a combination of working at Digital Nest, getting access to their career development, and simultaneously have our teachers working alongside Digital Nest staff to provide that credit recovery. So the students will be able to have the best of both worlds. They'll be able to make up the credits that we need them to make up while still being able to be involved in Digital Nest and getting the career development work that will hopefully motivate them to stay connected to learning and stay connected to the school. So we're proud of this MOU and proud of the partnership that will allow us to do that work. Currently, this pilot that we're referring to is for summer school. It is for students that are in need of credit recovery, but still want to have a connection with Digital Nest and do some career development with them during summer. Yes.
No. Okay. Go ahead, Perla, and then I'll make my way down.
Is the program only for credit recovery?
So in this pilot, it is. So there is another component that allows for students that are not in credit recovery. This one specifically addresses a concern that we had over last summer, that students that needed credit recovery were excluded. So there's other programs for students that are higher performing, but this specifically is for students that need credit recovery.
And I know in my high school, they make it a requirement for technology credits or something. And usually the students take intro to computers, but Digital Nest could also be like a way to get those technology credits.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so we're working on that pathway with them as well through Cabrillo. So we're working with dual enrollment courses with them.
I was just wondering with this, is there a cap on the number of students that they will be able to handle and take in the summer? And
yeah, so
what is that?
Yes, yeah, so
does that fulfill the need for the district?
No, but as with all pilots, we want to start small and make sure that it's positive. So they have said that we would be able to start with 40 students, and so we'll be starting with 40 students and hopefully expanding it over the years. But when we sat down, we actually did multiple sessions working with them, and when we sat down with their program people, they felt that 40 was the most that they could do. Because the goal is really to do career development. So it's not just about the credit recovery, but it's about getting them into these internships, job shadowing, and other opportunities. So at this point, it starts with 40. And if we can build their capacity and our capacity will increase over time.
Well, and just to kind of piggyback on that, is one of the issues, is it a staffing issue or is it a space location issue? I get why you're saying the 40 to start, but is that part of the other factor?
Yeah, so it's not a space this? It's not a space issue, because they've actually been able to take advantage of their location near Cabrillo, and Cabrillo has a lot of empty. It is a staffing issue. So they have so many staff and they want a particular ratio, which is why the MOU is there, with an extra cost. Because what we're doing is we're providing them with funding so that their staff can be there for the entire day. Because usually their staff is not there in the summers in the morning, and their staff will be there the entire day.
So this PO appears that it's for $12,000.
It's up to, not to exceed $12,000.
That does not seem like enough money to do what we're asking them to do.
So remember, we will continue to take on the cost of our staff.
We have staff there concurrently to their staff.
Exactly. Yeah, this is just to pay for the 4 hours that they usually wouldn't be there, and that's the amount that they requested. And so I said, that's a deal.
That is a deal. So thank you to Digital Nest. I think there's value in our collaboration, and in the future, I would like to see that that sum be increased. Thank you.
So I think for so long, at least just summer school has had such a negative connotation that's only for students who are making up units, right, and credits and classes and falling behind. And I think this is definitely a step in the right direction in twisting that to something positive, something that students are going to benefit from and feel fully engaged in. So I think it's an amazing, amazing program to start off. But in the future, I would like to see this opportunity be expanded to fulfill the need of the district.
Of course.
So I'm glad that we just keep finding ways to work with Digital Nest. I think that they've done a really phenomenal job, and I think they're doing really well with their new location in Salinas too. This is great. I think it's a great deal. Just one little nitpicky thing. Rich Buse's name is still on here.
Well,
as
that
the
would
director.
Be a problem. Yeah, so. No, that's not true. Yeah. So we will make sure and make that correction prior to signing.
Okay, great. I think it's great.
Nice. Thank you.
Nice work. Again, an action item. So I will ask.
Move to approve.
That was easy. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Of course, none. Motion passes 6-0-1. So moving on to item 9.5, approval of a class description for a payroll analyst. And this is a report by our Director of Classified and Human Resources, Pam Shanks. Hi, Pam.
Hi. Is the microphone on?
Yep.
Oh. Jonah, did you want to?
I just wanted to introduce you. So President DeRose, Board Trustee Dr. Rodriguez, I'm deferring this to our Director of Classified Personnel to provide you a more in-depth explanation of this item.
Good evening. I'll make this brief tonight. The item you have before you is a new class description called Payroll Analyst. There are four payroll employees, or four of the employees in the payroll department did request to be reclassified this past year. So at the Personnel Commission meeting in December, on December 14th, the Personnel Commission did take action to reclassify them. Sometimes when reclassifications happen, there's already an existing job description. Sometimes there's not. In this case, there was not, and so a new description needed to be written. In this case, the title is Payroll Analyst. This job description more closely fit the duties that the employees are performing after we did a thorough study of their jobs. So the payroll analyst classification is being presented this evening in order for the board to establish the duties of the classification. Again, as I mentioned, it was approved by the Personnel Commission in December, and they placed the position on range 50 of the classified employees' salary schedule. So this evening, I'm asking the board to approve the new class description and also the salary schedule attached, which shows the new position that was established.
Any speakers to this item?
None.
Okay. Any board comments?
I have one.
Yep.
Will all four of these employees be then promoted into this position as analyst, or?
It's a reclassification. So yes, we did a thorough examination of their the job duties that they perform, and so there are four employees in that department that will be moving into this position.
And then will they be replaced by other employees?
Or? No. Okay. The four positions will remain the same. It will just be changing from what's called currently a payroll technician to a payroll analyst. So it's just a change in their job title and pay range.
Is that all, Kim?
The cost to the district, I know it was on here, I think.
It's about $10,500 total for all four, because again, these are four current employees that exist on the salary schedule on a certain range, and so they're moving up a handful of ranges to the new position.
And so it's $10,000 per employee? Or
$10,000 total for all four.
For a full year?
Yes.
Thank you.
Are there any other questions or comments from the board?
So we're not adding any new people in there.
No.
It's the same folks.
Yes.
And we're just reclassifying what they're actually doing.
Right. We sometimes will have job descriptions that don't fully accurately describe work that employees are doing, or their jobs have changed over time. And so that's what this is. We've taken a look at their jobs, and again, this description more closely matches that work that they do every day. So, but yes, there's no new positions. This is it's just four existing employees that we're changing their job title.
Okay, thank you.
So this is also an action item. So I'm looking for a motion to approve and a second.
I'll move approval.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? No opposition, so the motion passes 6-0-1. Thank you. And item 9.6 is approval of a new class description, Family Services Advocate. Thank you. I was just going to go get that.
Jump right in. This is my second item this evening. Our migrant and seasonal Head Start programs are required to support families in areas such as health, nutrition, and social services. The district did not have a classification that was written that really accurately described the work that is needed by this program. And so I did work with the director, Angelica, on this description to make sure that we had a position that we could more accurately recruit for in order to fill these positions. And the class description that was established is called Family Services Advocate. And it was approved by the Personnel Commission at their December meeting and was placed on range 36. So this evening for this one, I'm also asking the board to approve the new class description and also the salary schedule, which shows the placement of the new description. This one, the positions that we would hire for were called parent education specialists. And again, that description didn't really describe what these employees did. The parent education specialist is on the same pay range as this position. So there is no additional cost because it's just when we hire for this position each season, it will be at the same pay range that we currently are hiring other employees in the past.
Any questions from the board?
Yes. I do. We get one from Kim. So this is essentially a social work position, but not being paid at a social work salary. So not even a bachelor's degree required in this position. So it's a paraprofessional position. Who supervises this group of people doing social work?
Angelica, and I don't know if Angelica would like to come up and answer some questions directly related to what the needs of the program are.
This is important work that these people are doing in terms of their advocacy and connecting to services and referrals and child welfare and all of that. Yeah. So I'm just wondering, do you have a master's level person supervising this group?
Well, this is a group that is providing direct services to the families, and it's a combination of duties that are related to health, community services, and parent education. So the district doesn't really have a position that aligns with the Head Start requirement. This position, the requirement for this position is a certification. It's Family Services Certification. It doesn't require a credential, and it doesn't require a BA degree. We have a couple of coordinators with BA degrees that are supervising these people. Those two coordinators don't have a master's degree, and they're not into social work. We have a health services supervisor with a BA degree, and we have a family services coordinator with a BA degree. And it's a group of 16 employees that are providing advocacy services for families.
Right. Okay. So we have PVPSA with a whole group of licensed social workers there. I think it would be helpful to have some type of collaboration in terms of supervising this group. What they're doing is really critical, and there's a lot of very sensitive information. So that's what social workers do, is health, juvenile justice, child welfare, advocacy, connect to referrals, counseling support. What they're doing is social work, so I think that they do need to be supervised by somebody who holds a license. So anyway, that's just my recommendation. You guys can do what you want, and I'll support this tonight, but I do feel like this is an important position and needs to be paid more. So you guys can chew on that for the future. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Yeah, I agree that it needs to be paid more. I agree that it probably needs to be paid more. You know, a migrant head start has always had, you know, difficulty in terms of where they get their funds, and they don't get state funds, they only get federal funds. Anyways, it's just that whole issue's been somewhat difficult being on their committee, being on their committee for so many years. And I'm sure that they would agree with you that they would want to, like, to pay that person higher. But they do just wonderful, wonderful work at Migrant Head Start in terms of their advocacy and for parents, and so much parent involvement, you wouldn't even believe it. I mean, you know, they have parent meetings, and there's 40 parents coming to the meeting. It's like, it's incredible. So in terms of parent advocacy and all the health care that they do for their children, I mean, it's incredible, the health care that they provide for their children. It's like, whoa, you wouldn't believe it. So yeah, it's an incredible program, and it would be great if they could pay everybody there higher. I'd like that too. So I'm going to go ahead and move that we approve that position. Yeah.
So ask for a second, and then I'll give my comments.
Second.
So it was my understanding that the parent education specialist, the original intent, and I could be wrong, but I don't think so, was they were to do outreach to bring parents more involved with their child's education. And I thought that they were doing a really good job. So is that not going to be a part of their work anymore?
No, we actually still will have parent education specialists. They're in a different department. This particular position is specifically in Migrant and Seasonal Head Start.
Okay, so it's separate.
Yes.
Because I thought I heard you say their work started to include other things. Okay. Good. I'm glad I'm wrong. So, good. Okay.
Yeah, the parent education specialist. Sorry.
There's a motion and second by, I think it was Kim, right? Okay. What? I'll say you. Okay, no offense. All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? None opposed. Motion passes 6-0-1. Thank you.
Thank you.
We're just moving right along, aren't we? Item 9.7, we're approved. This is an item to ask for approval of Resolution 17-18-18, acknowledging School Counseling Week.
Yes, President DeRose, Board Trustees, Dr. Rodriguez, with great pleasure, we propose this resolution in anticipation of National School Counseling Week, February 5th to the 9th, 2018. We would like to acknowledge the invaluable work of our school counselors in helping students explore their abilities, strengths, interests, and talents, identifying and utilizing community resources, nurturing student strengths, both personal and academic, and delivering a continuum of support that lower barriers to learning, and creating and maintaining a comprehensive developmental school counseling programs to be an integral part of the educational process that enables all students to achieve success in school.
Okay, and any speakers or board comments?
No speakers.
Yep. I move to accept this resolution.
I'll second the motion, but can I make one comment?
Yes, and then I'll make mine.
Thank you. So I always feel that we are giving resolutions for approval, but we never really know what happens on the school sites, as part of the recognition. Is there something that we do, something special that we do, or is it just something that we approve and that's the end of it? Or does it get presented at the different school sites and our counselors get recognized for the amazing work that they're doing?
There are various different weeks, and I know for school administrators and executive secretaries, we do acknowledge them. And with the counselors, I will be working closely, particularly with our Ed Services team as well as Mrs. Ann Smith, so that we make sure that the sites are aware of the invaluable service that our counselors provide for our students in the district, and our board approving this resolution to acknowledge their invaluable service.
Yeah, I mean, just moving forward with any resolution in support of X week, right, in celebration of their work, I think we should be doing something more than just approving this on school board level.
So just to make a note, so it was Alicia and now it will be Eva. After each resolution that's passed, we do send it out to the entire community. That includes our community partners, but every single staff member receives the resolution as well. What we could do for you in the future, and we can start with this one, is provide the update of what happened afterwards in our report so that you know what we did. In order to honor people.
Thank you.
Okay. So I'm happy to support this as well. In my work life, I actually do get to work pretty closely with the counseling staffs of all of the high schools, and it's amazing the amount of work that they do. And I would like to make it one of the priorities of the board to increase the staffing levels in the counseling offices as we can, because the ratios are ridiculous and students suffer if they can't get in to see their counselor. And that affects our college going rates. It affects so much. And they're asked to do a lot, not just at their school site, but from the partner colleges. We have meetings every month with them at Cabrillo, and every time they go to the meeting, it's another pile of work that they're coming. We all have that, right? Whenever you go to a meeting, you bring more work back. So I just want to recognize that they do work hard, as everybody does, but this is the week where we're recognizing them, so I just wanted to share that.
Okay. And I just want to also add exactly to what you were saying. For the amount of, or their load that they have, they do a tremendous amount of work, and I think that when we can afford to do more, we should do more and add counselors at the sites when we can do more. Thank you. Yep.
Okay, with that, I will ask for a motion.
I have a motion and a second.
Oh, we do. Mm-hmm. That's right. So we'll call for a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Of course, none. Motion passes 6-0-1. Thank you. Item 9.8 is Oh, we're revisiting the board representation on our committees that we have, and we do still have some openings.
Thank you.
And so, Michelle, did you want to open this one? It says report by you.
Okay, great. So as you know, one of the activities that the board does is to be incorporated into the community and through the district work through the committees. And so we just wanted to make sure and provide the opportunity for all the board members to participate in the various committees, just because it winds up providing an important voice for yourself and also the students and parents that you represent. So we have various committees. For the majority were present, and so we wanted to make sure that had happened. I did want to note for Trustee Yajiro, we had already had a conversation, and so some of his committees have already been, he's already been allocated to those committees.
Thank you.
And so that is represented here. So for instance, for an example, number 8, the dropout committee, Trustee Yajiro always is part of that, so he's already included in that, and we still have 2 spots on top of that.
Oh, in addition to that?
Yes, in addition to you, there's 2 additional positions that are available, places that are available.
So usually when we have this come forward, we have it like in a grid format where it shows who's serving on it currently and any openings that we have. And I know we did that in December, but I don't remember, so... I don't know if any Ava or Alicia has that.
I'd like.
Okay, thank you very much. Ask and you shall receive. So let me go through this. It doesn't look like it's in. There we go. So on the Community Advisory Committee for SELPA, we have Kim and Karen serving. And we do have 1 place available. So is anybody interested in serving on that committee? We don't.
The good news about that committee is it meets at night. So for those of us who have full-time jobs during the day, it's a doable committee because you can make it on a Tuesday
month,
night.
Once a month, 6 p.m. It's on Tuesdays?
I can't remember. But
okay. Well, there are some dates here. February 6th, March 6th, April 10th, and May 1st. So those are Tuesdays? Yes, they are. So those are Tuesdays. Does anybody have the availability and desire? If not, we can go with the 2 board members. So go ahead and leave that one. For DLAC, we also have 1 space available. We have Maria and Karen currently serving there. And that's once a month on Tuesdays from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. They do not conflict with the community advisory for SELPA. Those are, last night was the first one, January 23rd, February 20th, March 20th, April 17th, and May 15th. Is anybody else interested in serving? So my question is, if it says there's 1 spot open, does it have to be filled?
No, we just want to give the opportunity for board members to participate.
Okay. Number 3 is the Intergovernmental Committee meeting, and this is
I'd like to serve on this committee.
Okay. This is a committee that comprises of staff and electeds from the city as well as the school district. And I have you as a maybe, so now it's a yes, mm-hmm. Willie.
Mm-hmm.
Maria and myself are also serving on that, and that's as many as we can do.
I would love to be an alternate on that committee.
Okay, Kim is alternate.
Someone can't make it. I would like to.
Okay. I know, she said alternate in case someone can't.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
What could be an option?
Okay.
Is
So we did look into that because there was some desire to have that, and the discussion was that they would be privy to a portion of that information if they were alternate, which would then break Brown.
Okay, that makes sense.
Even if I didn't get an agenda for anything, I just showed up for a meeting? Okay.
Okay, Migrant Head Start, or actually I should look at this. Yes, we do have a couple of spaces available. Karen is currently serving on this committee, and this meets once a month on the second Thursday, again in evening at 7 p.m. Is there anybody else who would like to serve on that committee?
Well, you can put my name down there.
Okay, Kim. Thank you, Kim.
It's in Spanish, but you can get a translator.
Okay, and PVPSA.
That's the right one.
We have myself and Kim as an alternate, but we do have a space available, so for three. So there was some questions about the number of people serving on that committee from the district. So if I wanted to propose that we do two and an alternate, or one and an alternate, which is the way it is right now.
Myself,
yes, superintendent. You're the president of that board, so I'm going to let you go ahead and.
So there was a question that came up at the last PVPSA board meeting if there was too much PVUSD representation on that board. We currently have myself as the president. There is only one board member technically there, but then we also have Mark, and then we also have the CBO, and we have Dr. Bilicic that is part of it as well. And so because of that, there was a question of, is there too much representation? Just because sometimes we're the only ones that are making the quorum. And so I would concur, although we did put this here, I would concur with President DeRose that it would probably be best to maintain it at one at this point, because staff is there to provide the expertise. The CBO, of course, the fiscal, because they're one of the only ones that are there that can kind of give checks and balances to the fiscal. And then Mark is there from the viewpoint of secondary, and Dr. Bilicic is there from the standpoint of the adult learner community that we need to serve as well, and the parent community. So
we don't hold a majority on that board.
That is correct.
As district, but it was brought up. So I think we've been functioning well from where we are. So Kim, would you like to be an alternate? Okay, good. Well, that's great. That's helpful. Okay, so we will move to the safety committee. Three places available. Willie has served on that.
What is it, committee?
Safety committee.
Committee, yes.
So that meets.
I would like to continue serving if it's all possible. The safety committee meets during the daytime, and I can.
Does it meet in the morning or in the afternoon?
Is it? It's during the day, correct?
The day.
At the district office quarterly.
But what time of the day?
It is in the afternoon so that teachers can be present. So it's generally around 2:30, 3 o'clock.
Okay, can't do that.
That would be hard for me to get to as well. Anybody else? Billy, it's going to fall on your shoulders. Sorry.
Okay.
Spectra, the Arts Education Committee. This is quarterly. I believe it used to be on Mondays at 4:30, but that hasn't been a committee that meets as often as I thought it was. So there was some confusion, I think, and I haven't been to a meeting in a while. So I would like to continue to attend that myself and Kim, or I'm the alternate. You're on there, Kim. If you want to continue.
Yeah,
okay.
I read all the, yeah, the afternoons. Mm-hmm.
I know, it's really hard for me too. I think that's really becoming really difficult for most board members.
Yeah, I think the reason for some of these being during the day is because we want teacher representation, and so it's difficult to get teacher representation when it's in the evenings.
Mm-hmm.
And so we try to do, so in this case, we try to do it after school is out, so that they can go straight from school to the meetings. So I understand it, that, for the Spectra and for the safety, it's really crucial that we have teacher representation.
Right. Yeah. I understand that. I understand that. And, you know, there's a lot of responsibilities and meetings that, and our work life that board members have to do. So I hope the public doesn't view this as us not being committed at all, but we have to juggle our employment as well. So let's move to dropout committee. So is that continuing to meet? It just says varies on the times.
So I was on the original dropout committee, and I'd like to continue. If nobody else wants to do it, I'd
well,
like
Maria,
to
do
it. Does it meet?
It's on there. It just says varies, so I'd like to kind of get an idea of how often they meet.
So in the last year, we met once. It hasn't been very active.
And we have to.
Right, and there's no set schedule for those meetings.
Okay.
So
Mark and Mr. Brewer can speak to it.
Dropout committee, so that'll be February 26th, April 23rd, September 24th, and November 19th.
What time does that meet, Mark?
What web page is that?
If you go under secondary education on the PBUSD website, which is the department page, and on the left, there's dropout committee window, and the first agenda is already posted under Williams now, so we'll advertising and posting that, and we'll also have a short public comment period, and we'll meet in the HR conference.
Okay. So
3:30.
So what I would suggest on all of these is just make sure these all get updated with the dates and times, and if we don't have them, we need to establish a better, more consistent way to know, because it's hard for board members to say yes or no if we don't have a schedule. So that would be great. Okay, so Maria and Willie, you want to continue, correct?
I really can't. So right now work is very hectic for me.
Okay.
So I wouldn't be able to make it 3:30.
All right.
Is there any way to move that to more of an evening meeting? You can take that for a review. That does not have to be answered right now, but again, that's something I'm super interested in, but I can't make 3:30.
Earlier in the morning, because I don't work right away. Earlier in the morning or later at night.
Something to consider, because I would love to serve on that committee, but it's just that timing doesn't work for me.
Okay. So we can get a follow-up from administration via email on these questions, and then we can post this publicly, right, when it's completed. Okay. The Healthy Start Steering Committee Collaborative has a couple of places.
I'm on it.
Oh, you are? Okay. Doesn't say that.
There's going to be a meeting coming up soon, like in a week.
Yes, March 7th or February 7th is the next one. Looks like once a month through May. Willie, you were on here as a maybe, because apparently you served on this committee prior.
Healthy Start?
Help.
No.
Oh, I'm looking at the wrong one. I'm so sorry. Yes, healthy start.
No, I won't be.
You weren't on that one. No. Sorry. Okay. And then CTE Advisory Board?
I would like to volunteer for this committee. CTE has been a big push of mine, so I'd like to.
Is Career Tech Education?
Oh, Career Tech Education.
It's the ROP at the, or what used to be ROP, now it's CTEC or something. I knew that you would want to be on that. And Kim as an alternate. Anybody else interested? That's got a lot of activity currently.
What time is it?
That one is meetings from 2 to 3:30. It looks like there are a couple of site visits and a couple of board meetings each year. There is a potential for more funding coming to K-12. It's in the proposed governor's budget for CTE. So there's going to be some activity, definitely.
I'd love to be on, except the time is kind of hard.
Okay. You're an alternate? Alternate, you want to stay there? So Willie and Kim as an alternate for that one. And then Health Benefits Committee. I think that that's an important one currently. I think it's becoming more active, right? Willie, you were on that. Do you want to continue?
Absolutely.
I think your expertise is
absolutely
really valuable there. This one meets the first Wednesday of the month from 2:15 to 4 in the district office. Is that one where there's a possibility that it could move a little bit later?
Basically it's set up so that the teachers and support people can come. So right. It's usually after school hours.
Okay. So 2:15 to 4, that's why. Right. So that's probably going to have to stay where it is.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anybody else who would like to serve on that and can? No.
Are there minutes for that, or is that?
Yes, there are. So I just want to note, and I know that Trustee Hajero is already aware, I just want it for the others that it is in observation capacity only due to restrictions within the collective bargaining agreement. It's just there to be witnessing and observing it. We do ask at time, the district has the ability to put in presentations. So for example, if a board member wants to present a presentation, that can happen, but it has to be agendized and scheduled. So for the most part, it's to observe and to be aware, and then they can provide support to the administration.
Okay. All right. So I think we're done with that item. And now, when we've done these in the past, it's an appointment, not an action item. Okay, so that's the action, is the appointments we just did. Okay.
Yes. Leslie, if I can also add, it's my understanding and agreement that I don't make presentations. I'll make presentations to the consultant who will check out things, and then if it's valuable, then the consultant who we hire to do these things, then he'll make the presentation. So I'm not like presenting stuff.
Okay.
So that's, but I do want to go and listen and hear what's going on.
I think that's great. Thank you. Okay. So now our report and discussion items, we have one, and this is one that we look forward to each year. This is our energy program report to the board. And this is by Steve Akamura, our energy education manager. Welcome, Steve. Thank you for waiting.
Here. Good evening, President DeRose, Superintendent Rodriguez, and the rest of the board. A little different than the board room at the other one, but let me see if I can figure this out. Okay, so I'm doing the energy program, and okay, I'm going to be talking about the update on the energy program itself, how much we've saved this year, Also update on the Prop 39 interior lighting project that we just finished. Update on the Cedar Chavez energy management system project that we just started last month. And then an update on the school water system lead testing that we did this last couple of months. And next slide. Okay, so electric and gas savings for this year, from September 2015 to August 2016, is 911,032% savings. Our water and irrigation savings from June to May is 44,000. That's a 7.8% savings. Okay, so for our Prop 39 interior lighting project, we did it at 8 school sites: Watsonville High, Aptos High, Pajaro Valley High School, Renaissance High, Aptos Junior, EA Hall Middle School, Cedar Chavez Middle School, and New School. We installed a combination of retrofit kits and/or brand new fixtures. And they were all LEDs.
That cost us 1.7?
Yeah, it was 1.7 million. What's the cost?
We didn't get any money for that?
So that was with Prop 39 funds, right? If you could explain what Prop 39 means, it means it's a grant.
Prop 39 was the funding grant that the state put out a few years ago. We've been doing projects in it. We've already did all the outside lighting to LED. We did these 8 schools to LED for the interior lighting, and we're doing some HVAC projects as well. And we need to get those done this year because the Prop 39 funds are running out, so we're trying to use as much money as we can to take advantage of that money. So the next slide is, and this is the energy management system upgrade for Cesar Chavez Middle School. The current energy management system at Cesar Chavez is not very robust. It's just basically turns the furnaces on and off on a schedule. We're switching to a Delta web-based energy management system. We plan to start upgrading all the schools to this system throughout the district. The new system is going to take care of the on and off schedules for the furnaces and HVAC systems. It'll turn off systems during the holidays, winter breaks, and stuff, times like that. It'll control temperature. It'll also give the teachers more control of the temperatures. Right now, we kind of set their temperatures, and if they want to change it, they have to call us. But this new system will have a thermostat that actually has opportunities for the teachers to change the temperatures. And we'll just kind of give them a range of temperatures that they can use. And it's a more modern system. It's a web-based system, so we can look at
it. Will it save us money?
Oh, yeah. It should save around 20-25% savings in energy. I think that's it. Oh, it also monitors a lot of functions, and it does a data logging, so we could actually see what a classroom does during the week. We could actually do a graph and plot its temperatures, and we can plot the supply temperatures to make sure that we see the supply temperatures go up so we know that the heater is working properly. Oh boy, barely see that. Okay, this is the lead testing that we just did. We completed it in December. And the state mandated water companies that if a school district does a formal letter that that they have to provide lead testing for their school sites. So in July, I wrote a letter to all our water districts asking if we can do this testing, and they all replied back. And we started in October. I can't see that. My eyes aren't that good. We started in October with Soquel Creek. They were the first ones that we did the testing with, and we did the four schools up in that area. And then we did Parle Valley Sunny Mesa Water District, which is basically Parle Middle School and Ohlone School. And then we did Cal Water, California Water, which is just Hall District. And then the big one was Watsonville City. That was the bulk of all our testing. And we finished those in just before the winter break started. And then I got the results for all the ones. I've got the results for all of them, but on this slide, it only says I got results for Soquel Creek, Parle Sunny Mesa, and Cal Water. And they all came out clean. So all those schools are good. But I just got an email from the city of Watsonville, and they gave me a list of our the schools in the city that they do, and all those came out clean too. So our entire district is good for lead. So, and that's my report. Any questions?
No speakers.
Willie and then Kim.
Thank you. Steve, one of your functions is to go around to the schools after hours and check to see if lights have been left on and things of that nature. Is that a function still of what you're doing?
I've been doing projects so much that I haven't been going out and doing those. So I really need to get back doing, going out and at nighttime and checking.
Do you see that as a money saver as to the energy costs? Is there any way to measure that?
Yeah, you can measure it. The program that I use to track our utilities does a pretty good job of measuring savings.
Good. The solar panels that we put up under Measure L,
uh-huh.
Has it been too early to see any savings at all from that? From
no,
those?
We've got about a year of savings, so we can generate those reports. The reason why our savings is fairly high this year compared to years in the past is probably a lot of that's from the solar. Also, it's from the outside lighting that we changed to LEDs. That's a big driver of that too.
Thank you. I received a whole bunch of wonderful letters from a class at EA Hall School,
mm-hmm.
asking about solar and so forth. And I would like to know, or maybe I can ask the superintendent later to see if you can come out and speak with me to the class there at EA Hall School.
Sure, I'd love to.
Good. Thank you.
All right. Okay.
It's so great to see you every year.
Thanks.
So the money that we've saved, the $900,000 in this last fiscal year, that was calculated off of what? Off of the year that we didn't have the solar arrays up? Or what do we...
Yeah.
How much did we save that much over from the year before, or is this going way back?
It uses the program that I use uses the algorithm to figure out savings, and I don't know how to explain that algorithm, but okay. I just go by that.
But I'm guessing for like the LED lights, like we're not going to have to replace the bulbs for 20
long
years
time,
or something.
Yeah.
So that's going to be a huge savings to our
that should be a
business
huge
services.
Savings, and we just did those 8 schools, so that's. About almost half the district. Mm-hmm. So,
How many HVAC projects will we have going through Prop 39?
We're planning on doing two HVAC projects right now.
Two.
Yeah, and then we still got the charter schools we got to do. So that'll be some HVAC as well as lighting.
And is this money that's already rolled into the district, or we pull it down as we push through each project?
We have that money.
I see.
We encumber it from the California Energy Commission.
That's great.
Manages Prop 39.
And how are the solar arrays doing everywhere? Is everything up and operational?
Yeah, they've been operational. The companies comes out and they clean the panels and service them. So.
And then my final question is about the lead testing. So I understand that potentially the water coming from each one of the different agencies is lead-free, but how about after it hits the school and goes through all the old pipes?
Yeah, that's a good question, because that's what this testing that we did does, because the water company, they're only obligated to do it up to the point of entry for
right.
to the school.
Right.
This lead testing, we did our samples at drinking fountains, and when we always incorporated one of the kitchens or the kitchen. So we did a test and sample in the kitchen, and then we do four around the school at all the drinking fountains.
So do you feel confident that we are lead free in all of our schools?
Yes, I do.
Great. Yeah. Thank you.
Excellent news.
Karen.
Hi. Well, obviously, I know why our electrical savings. Obviously, I know why that happened. But I was just wondering, how was it that it happened when you said that you saved $40-something thousand for water and irrigation? How did that happen? I mean, how was that?
That it's the savings that the guys in the field, they've been working on plugging a lot of the leaks that we've had. And they've been, dialing back the landscape.
They've been what now?
They've been working on plugging all the leaks that we have.
Okay.
So a lot of irrigation have some bad leaks. So they've been working really hard this last year in doing that. We've had some leaks in some of the schools that we've been able to fix. We got a new device that listens for leaks in the ground, and that's worked out really well for us.
It does what now? What does it do?
It's a listening device, and it actually can hear the water leaks inside the ground.
Oh, so that's why they've been able to fix a lot of leaks.
Yeah, they've been catching a lot.
They have that piece of equipment that's
right,
helped quite a bit.
Yes. Oh.
And so, but you say water and irrigation, meaning that what is water and irrigation? Also, the
well,
two?
The water is the water that goes into the school that they goes to the drinking fountains and all that stuff, and then irrigation is just for the landscape irrigation.
And they found the leaks in mostly the irrigation part, right?
A lot of it was the irrigation part, yeah. But we also found leaks in the distribution system to the schools as well.
But so when you say water, you say fountains? Huh?
Oh, well, any kind of leak that's under the ground. Most of it was in the ground. Leaks that we found.
Okay, through irrigation pipes in like the fields and things, Karen.
Not in the fields. It would have to be in our schools, obviously.
Oh, but each school has a field, right? The kids play on fields that are full of grass that are irrigated.
No, I know. Yeah. I understand what you're saying about the irrigation. I was just wondering about the water part of it you were saying. I understand the irrigation part.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we found a lot of leaks, and we got them fixed.
Okay.
Any other board comments? Steve, I think I heard that there's more Prop 39 funding that is going to be proposals were going to be awarded, I think, tomorrow, January 25th. Have we applied for those? Because is this the last round? Because it was a multi-year,
round. Yeah,
right?
This is the last round.
And are we applying for those?
Yeah.
Did we apply?
Yeah.
And what does it look like? Because I know there's some feelings about how it may fall out.
Yeah, we're trying hard to get contractors to get on these projects, and right now we're like right in the middle of trying to get these buttoned down.
I couldn't hear you.
We're right in the middle of trying to get these contracts filled right now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, but are we getting the next round of funding?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay,
we'll,
great.
We'll get it.
Excellent. Good news. Okay, thank you. And that was not an action item, but always good news to hear. Thank you very much. Our next item, I believe, is 11, our consent agenda. Is there a motion to approve?
I'd like...
And is there a second?
I would like to defer one item.
Okay, what item is that?
11.10.
Okay.
I believe it's...
Is that a second also? Okay, so who moved approval?
I did. Okay. And my motion to...
Okay, did you get that? Okay. Yeah. So we have a motion and a second with the deferral of 11.1. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? None opposed? Item passes 6-0-1.
Okay.
Okay.
11.10, the Rio Del Mar project, right.
Okay, so yeah. Now to the deferred, and Willie, did you have questions on 11.10?
Not a question directly, but I need to abstain on this item, mainly because the owner of the company's been a long time friend of mine going all the way back to high school, as well as being a client of mine. So there's a conflict of interest maybe, and I just to have it clear and up front, I need to abstain on this project. I recognize the fact that it went through the process of being vetted and the company receiving the award is the low bidder, and so all of the steps were taken, but I think just to clarify that I should abstain. Okay. And that was why I asked to pull this off the agenda.
Okay. Is there any other discussion on this item?
No. I'd like to make a motion.
I'll second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Nope. Let's try that again. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions?
Aye.
Okay. Let's see if I can get this right.
After all,
5-0-1-1. Yes. Okay. That was so professional. Sorry.
And I just want to add a comment, if I may. We already voted on this, but I just have to make a comment that on the consent is the approval of the minty white fencing around the school and so forth, and I know the principal is here, Victor is here, and I just want to commend both of them for working together to get the fencing and the lawn and the modernization for minty white finished and done. Thank you.
Okay, so we are now at item 13, and that is reconvene in closed session if necessary, and it is necessary. We got through three items when we met earlier this evening, 2.4, 2.5, and 2.8, which we'll report on when we come back. We'll go back and we will be discussing 2.2, 2.3, 2.6, 2.7, 2.9, 2.10, and 2.11. So we still have a lot of work to do. So I'm going to ask if we can get a motion to extend the meeting, because we are going to be doing actions. And we can't take action past 10:30 unless we extend the meeting.
I'll make a motion to extend the meeting to 11:30.
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Abstain or no? Why would it be an abstention? Is it because you're not going to stay? Okay. So motion passes 5-0-1-1. No, 5. Yes, okay. Okay, we are back from our second closed session meeting, and we will go ahead and report out on the items that we discussed and the action that we took. And Karen Osmondson will read out on 2.1, which is for expulsions.
The recommendation of district administration for a suspended expulsion for the remainder of 2017-2018 school year. Placement at another school for 17-18-020.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Motion passes 5-0-2.
I move to approve the recommendation of the district administration for a suspended expulsion for the remainder of 2017-2018 with placement. I'm so sorry about that. For 17-18-019.
Is there a second?
A second.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? None. Passes 5-0-2.
I move to approve the recommendation of the district administration for a.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0-2.
Approve the recommendation of the district administration for a full expulsion for the remainder of 2017-2018.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0-2. Thank you, Karen. And action on certificated public employee, item 2.2, Maria.
So under item 2.2, I move to approve the certificated personnel report as presented by the district administration with the additions of 4 new hires, 6 leave of absences, and 5 separations.
Is there a second?
A second.
All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0-2. And classified?
I move to approve the classified personnel report as presented by the district administration with the addition of 3 leave of absences and 3 separations.
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0-2.
Under item 2.4, a separation settlement agreement for classified employee number 3052 was approved at a regularly called meeting of the Governing Board of the Pajaro Valley Unified School District on the 24th of January 2018 by the following vote, 5-0-2.
And that was item what?
2.4.
Okay.
And under that same item, the board approved the release and reassignment of an administrative position for employee number 4875 by the following vote, 5-0-1-1. And under item 2.6, the board voted 5-0-2 to settle workers' compensation claim for one employee. Under item 2.7, the board voted 5-0-2 to approve a workers' compensation settlement for, under item 2.6, the board voted 5-0-2 to settle workers' compensation for one employee. Under item 2.7, the board voted 5-0-2 to approve a workers' compensation settlement for also one employee. Under item 2.8, the board voted 5-0-2 to approve a $16,400 settlement with Kasaran Architects. And under item 2.11, the board voted 5-0-2 to approve settlement with one special ed student.
Thank you. So our last item is upcoming board meetings, and it's come to the attention of the administration and the board president that the next board meeting on February 14th, we will have 3 board absences and possibly a 4th. So what I would like to do is move our February 14th meeting to February 21st. That way we can be sure to have a quorum. And that would mean that we would have a meeting on the 21st and then again the following week, the 28th. But I just feel like it's important to have all board members present. And mine is due to a long planned vacation. And I know that other people had had plans already to begin with. And I think, you know.
Plus, it's Valentine's Day.
It's Valentine's Day. And we don't approve our board calendar until January 1st. And a lot of us, if we have spring vacation plans, have already made them. So is February 21st agreeable with the board?
Yes.
I'm okay with that.
Yes? Okay. So I'd like to ask for a motion to approve making that change on the board meeting calendar.
Make a motion to change our board meeting from February 14th to February 21st, 2018.
I'll second that motion.
You. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, motion passes 5-0-2. Thank you. And we are adjourned.
Too early.